This video is a follow-up to my original Castlevania NES video. As such, it is highly recommended that you watch that video before proceeding with this one. It will also feature spoilers for both the original Castlevania and Vampire Killer. If you've already watched it, then let's get on with this. So, Vampire Killer is pretty weird. It was released on the MSX2, which was an 8-bit home computer system, back in 1986, and was supposed to be a sort of port of the NES Castlevania game. It only ever got released in Japan and Europe, though I couldn't find the European version of the game anywhere, so I'm playing the Japanese version. Doesn't really matter that much, as most of the game's dialogue is still only in English anyways. Kinda weird, but I'm not complaining. But while the story and some visuals were lifted straight from the NES game, the level design and overall structure was so radically different, to the point where it's kind of impossible to consider these two to be the same game. So as such, it is getting its own video, which you're watching right now. I actually first played Vampire Killer earlier this very year, and I was so utterly perplexed by its sheer existence and how broken and horrible it was, that I put it down before even finishing the fourth stage. But you know what? I might have been a bit too harsh on it. Let's go back and check if there's any value in this piece of software. This is Vampire Killer for the MSX2. Right off the bat, this game commits a cardinal sin I really don't like. While it is a part of the Castlevania franchise, it doesn't have the Castlevania name anywhere on it. It's just Vampire Killer. I get that it would be weird if they just called this title Castlevania since it's so radically different from the original, but I think just giving it a subtitle or something wouldn't have really hurt. But on to more important stuff. Before I start talking about the level design and structure, let's get the visuals out of the way. Despite only releasing about a month after the original game, Vampire Killer is a pretty nice visual leap over it. Just looking at the first screen of it and comparing it to the NES version, it is clear that Vampire Killer offers up a lot more detail, and it's a lot clearer what everything on screen is supposed to be, whereas in the NES version, some of the sprite work tended to look a bit messy. There are also quite a few creative liberties taken with some elements. For example, the long hallway in stage 15. The original version had a bunch of empty portraits everywhere, but in Vampire Killer, these portraits feature Dracula's face, some shaved and some of when he went through that weird Santa Claus phase. These little details definitely help Vampire Killer stand out, and provide a nice flair to it. However, all of these nice little upgrades do come with a pretty sizable cost, and that is that the game just feels a lot more static and lifeless. Let me try to explain. In the original, the screen often scrolled along with Simon, and the screen transitions are minimal. But in Vampire Killer, the game is always locked on one static screen, and each time you move out of it, the game loads it out and loads in the next screen. And that combined with the far away of frame rate kinda just makes the whole game feel sluggish and kinda off compared to the original. The soundtrack locally does fare up a bit better in my opinion. It is pretty noticeably different from the NES OST, with it using a different sound hardware, but it's not necessarily worse, just different. I will say that I definitely do prefer the NES tracks over these, but that's likely mostly because I played and heard them first, and I'm more used to them. There is actually one new track in Vampire Killer, that being the credits theme, and it is a pretty good one too. Even if it does definitely feel very out of place with the rest of the game's soundtrack, and I'll definitely take the original credits theme over this any day. But okay, enough standing around, let's get on with the gameplay. In order for us to truly understand this game, I'll first need to explain how it operates. Vampire Killer is comprised of 18 stages, roughly following the NES version, with some borrowed level design chunks. However, unlike the NES game, the stages themselves are far more non-linear, and are more like mazes, filled with enemies to fight and lamps to break. Throughout them, you'll also find these keys, that will let you open up treasure chests that can contain useful items, such as other treasures to increase your score, sub-weapons, and maps. You'll also come across breakable walls that can contain such items too. And sometimes, when you break a wall, you'll find these merchants, which are apparently old women, according to the wiki at least, and will be able to use your hearts to buy items from. However, the main thing you're after in these stages are the white keys, which let you open up the door to the next stage. Okay, now that I've laid out the ground rules of this game, let's start breaking them down one by one so that I can explain to you why this whole thing just completely falls apart. Let's start with the controls. Simon himself handles just like he did in the NES game, meaning lock jumps, massive knockback, and whip delay. But these aren't the elements I have issue with. No, my main issue is the button layout. This game is played on a keyboard, though I was able to pretty easily emulate it and use the controller instead, which I definitely prefer overall. But anyways, on a keyboard, this is the default layout. The left and right arrow keys move Simon, the up arrow key makes him jump and climb upstairs, the down key makes you duck and climb downstairs, the spacebar makes you attack, F1 pauses the game, and F2 shows you the map, at least if you have it. So first of all, since the up key is used both for jumping and climbing stairs, it means that if you try to jump while there are stairs above you, you'll just climb them instead. This happened to me pretty frequently, and is pretty annoying in and of itself, but my primary issue is with using the stopwatch and holy water sub-weapons. In order to use the stopwatch, you have to press down while in mid-air, and to throw a holy water, you press left or right in mid-air to throw it in the respective direction. This kinda baffles me. First of all, only being able to use the holy water while in mid-air heavily limits its capabilities. Though it is pretty cool that the game lets you carry both the stopwatch and the holy water at the same time, which were the two best sub-weapons in the original game. But secondly, this game is played on a keyboard, which has like 5 million keys. I have absolutely no idea why they had to limit the control scheme like this. I get that they didn't want it to be too overwhelming by having each of the key to something unique, but would it have really hurt if they had C be the jump key, X for the stopwatch and Z for the holy water? That's just 3 additional keys, and they're all pretty close to the spacebar as it is. So I don't really see the issue with mapping those commands to these keys. But let me tell you, oh boy, my issues with the key layout are just the tip of this vampire killing iceberg. The other sub-weapons you can find are the axe, cross, and knife. The knife and cross act just like they did in the original game, but the axe just acts exactly like the cross, making it absolutely pointless. And instead of them acting as secondary weapons, they outright replace your whip attack until they run out, and they don't even use the hearts you find as ammo. They just have an arbitrary amount of uses until they just run out eventually. And what's even more annoying is that if you had a whip upgrade before getting them, they just outright replace it and don't give it back to you. When you get your whip back, it's just a weak whip. There are some items you can only use a few times that I do like, such as the wand, which acts as a sort of magic key that can open many treasure chests, but could only be used around 5 times. Now that's something I can get behind. Can't really say the same for items like the map, which could also only be used around 5 times. I honestly think they should've just made the map a permanent upgrade you get around halfway through the game or so, as that's when the stages start getting a lot bigger. And I also take issue with the grandma merchants. You can sometimes find these books that hide or lower their prices. Yep, there is an item in the game that makes the other items more expensive. Because game design, I guess. I do think it's pretty smart that the hearts are used both as ammo and currency. It makes it so that you have to decide whether to save up your hearts so that you can use a sub-weapon a lot, or use a lot of them up at once so that you can get some cool new item. Is what I would like to say. Because you see, the issue is that if you have enough hearts for the item they offer you, and you don't want to buy it, well, tough shit, the game forces you to buy it. So you might waste a bunch of hearts you gathered up on a stupid dagger or something. So if you get enough of their shit after that, they can just outright kill these grandmas. In fact, you have to attack them in order for them to offer up the items they're selling to you in the first place. But if you keep attacking them after that, then they'll eventually start gaining hearts. Though sometimes you'll also lose hearts by attacking them. It seems completely random, and eventually they'll die. You can even kill them if you did buy something from them, and you'll get some sweet, sweet points to add to the pointless score, which doesn't even give you an extra life after getting enough of this time. It is completely pointless this time around. In fact, I have not found a single extra life throughout my entire playthrough of this game. And that is especially detrimental, since if you get a game over in this game, you get booted right back to the title screen. There are absolutely no continues. It is ruthless. This game is long enough as it is, with most levels being about 3 times as long as their NES counterparts, but only being able to die twice throughout the whole game makes it practically unplayable without cheats, in my opinion. So yeah, I use the save state every time I enter the new level. I made sure not to abuse them, even if I kinda wanted to a lot. Luckily, after you beat a boss, you get your health restored like in the NES version, but unlike it, once you start the next stage, you lose all of the upgrades and items you got on the previous stage other than the map. Meaning you basically have to start from scratch, and most of the stuff you got earlier just got thrown right in the fucking trash. You do keep the hearts from the previous stages, which is something that didn't carry over in the NES version, so that's nice. But all of these issues don't even come close to my biggest gripe with this game, that being the level design. My god. So, you know how in the original game, all of the stages are finely crafted around Simon's controls and offer the great challenge that felt fair and rewarding? Well, you might as well chuck all of that right out of the fucking window, because these levels feel like they are just thrown together using a map randomizer, and then slightly altered so that they can technically be beatable. Sometimes you enter a screen, and an enemy just immediately hits you. You can't do anything about it. Or better yet, you can get into situations where the only way to move on is literally to die. There are some jumps that are damn near pixel perfect to the point where it doesn't even feel like you're supposed to be able to make them. But no, you have to make those jumps in order to move on. You know how you use keys to open treasure chests? Well, you can only carry one key at a time, but the game often puts multiple keys and multiple treasure chests right next to each other, so you'll have to backtrack to get them all. Some treasure chests are also pretty damn out of the way, so you'll go around the whole level, get a key, get at the chest, and more often than not, you'll find something completely useless like a shield or some shit. I mostly just searched for the white keys in order to get most levels done with, because I didn't want to stay in any of them for a second longer. But hey, at least the lamps you break still give you some nice items occasionally. But sometimes they also drop out these blobs that will instantly attack you as soon as they show up. Come on! In fact, that is the one phrase I have said to myself over and over throughout this entire playthrough. Come on. Especially after I finally made it to the end of stage 10 after 12 minutes of trial and error, only for me to accidentally jump into a wall, stop locking the game, and forcing me to load up my save state from the beginning of the stage. And you tell me this game was playtested. The game does occasionally offer up a few more sections that are a bit more linear, but the level design in them isn't any better than in the non-linear part, and they still have all of the annoying mechanics from them too, so I don't really care for these either. Most of the white keys are found in breakable walls, meaning you are forced to whip every wall in the game in the vain hope that you'll find the key that will bring you ever so close to your salvation. The original game had breakable walls too, but they only ever had bonus items to keep you going, not important items you must get to finish the game. There is a pretty nice item that shows you where the breakable blocks are, but it's pretty rare, and kinda just creates an annoying solution for a problem that didn't need to exist. Near the end of the game, they just kinda gave up with them. Stage 16 has two pathways. You'd assume that the lower one will have the white key, and the upper one will have the door to the next stage, so you go through the bottom pathway, and you eventually come across the white key. But it's in a location that you can't get out of, so if you get it, you are practically softlocked and have to fall down and die. But if you keep going, you get at the end of the bottom pathway and find another white key. What? Up until this point, every stage only had one white key. So to just break this rule right near the end and put another key that softlocked you is absolutely ridiculous. And you know what? That isn't even the worst part. After you get the white key and go back to the start of the stage, you start taking the upper path and go to the door that will take you to the next level. But right near the door, you'll find the level's third white key. Why? Why would they put yet another white key right next to the door? This basically makes the entirety of the bottom pathway absolutely worthless. And you know what? Stage 17 is somehow even worse. This one has two white keys, one of which is literally unobtainable, and the other one is obtainable but softlocked to you and forces you to die. And remember, as it was originally designed, you could only die two times before having to replay the entire game. But anyways, in order to get said white key, you have to go all the way around the stage, break this one specific block, and then go all the way back to the area with the white key, and now a block that you couldn't break earlier is now magically breakable. Wow! And just to make it clear, this game isn't really that hard per se, it's just incredibly annoying and tedious. But anyways, now that we've got that key, we can finally go and face Dracula, is what I would like to say. But in reality, Vampire Killer decides that enough is never enough, and that's another level you have to go through before facing off against Dracula. Now to be fair, this is definitely one of the more bearable levels in the game, but still, why did it need to exist? It means that every time you die to Dracula, you have to go through that whole stage again, which takes around 5 minutes by the way. But anyways, let's finish this off by talking about the bosses. Unlike most of the game, the bosses are mostly the same as their NES counterparts. They move around a bit differently and are a bit more junky overall, but nothing too noteworthy. None of them are immune to the stopwatch, which means that if you have it when getting to them, you'll be able to take care of them pretty easily. However, I did not have the stopwatch when I got to Dracula, and his battle is the only one that's radically different. So let's talk about it. I will give the game a bit of credit for putting an old woman that sells a healing potion right before the boss fight against Dracula, probably the best bit of level design in this entire package. But as for the fight itself, first of all, the arena is totally different. Instead of the epic arena from the original that was foreshadowed and shown earlier on, this Dracula battle just takes place in a random room with a giant portrait of Dracula hanging in the back. Which does look pretty neat for an 8-bit game, I'll give it that. But secondly, remember when I complained that the first phase of the original Dracula battle required too much waiting? Well, you could probably get through it about 4 times in the time it takes to take care of the first phase in Vampire Killer. He teleports around so slowly and takes so many fucking hits to take down. His attacking projectile is also different. The 3 fireballs he shoots out are a lot more spread out, meaning you have to jump, attack him, and then immediately run away from him and duck under the fireball. Do that for about 6 minutes straight and you'll move on to the second phase. Instead of turning into the Cookie Monster like in the first game, Olaf is got spew out as he proceeds to possess the giant Dracula pending in the back and shoots out bats from his mouth at you. And people said the Cookie Monster was ridiculous. But yeah, this fight is also pretty brutal. You have to eat the glowing gem on top of his head, which has a pretty small hitbox, and make sure to avoid the bat he spews out. I would honestly be pretty okay with this battle if it wasn't for the fact that if you lose, you have to go through the entire stage along with the first phase again, which, let me remind you, takes about 12 minutes. All of that, just to have a shot at the final boss fight. And again, let me remind you that you have to do all of that along with the rest of this entire game, while only being able to die twice. I frankly have a hard time believing that anyone who isn't a speedrunner ever beat this game without any sort of cheat devices or emulation features. But let me tell you, the absolute sense of relief I got when I finally took him down after over an hour of trial and error, knowing that it was all over and I'll never have to play this game ever again, was truly immense. Instead of the epic final shot of Castlevania crumbling as the sun finally rises once again, we just get a black screen telling us that you finished the game and peace has been restored. It isn't even poorly translated, so I can't have a good laugh at this. It's just generic text with unfitting music, followed by the credits. After that, you go back to the first stage for another hard mode, where the enemies are faster, but I don't fucking care. If it wasn't already obvious by the tone of this review, I kinda hate this game. And I honestly think this might be one of the worst games I have ever played. With its horribly implemented mechanics and absolutely atrocious level design. I will give it a little bit of credits for this though. It could have just been a watered down port, but instead, they chose to make it something unique. And you know what? That's commendable. But with how terrible the end product turned out, I don't think it was worth it. If you like Vampire Killer, good for you. I can definitely see where the appeal in this title is. And I can see it be pretty fun for speedrunning, if you're crazy enough to attempt it. But I personally did not enjoy it for one bit, and I don't think it's worth checking out, even if you are a huge Castlevania fan. I will see you next time, when we'll take a look at the first real sequel to the original game, Castlevania 2, Simon's Quest. See you all then.